Hi, everyone. Welcome to today's FIA webinar, Margin Processing, the Clearing Firm Perspective. Today's event is a sponsored session. SmartStream has been kind enough to sponsor this event, and I will be passing it along to Linda Kaufman from SmartStream to give an introduction and overview for today's session. Linda?
Thanks, Don, for that wonderful introduction. It's great to be here today, and I'm really looking forward to the panel discussion. SmartStream RDU is a business unit of SmartStream Technologies focused on delivering high-quality security reference data. RDU works closely with the FCM community, both directly and through our risk and margin analytics partners, in particular in helping to provide identifiers and clearing codes on listed derivatives in order to help clients and third-party vendors communicate with one another. I'm really happy that SmartStream could help bring this informative session to the industry today. In a moment, I'm going to hand the mic back over to Don Byron, who you just heard from. Don will be your moderator today. He is head of global industry operations and execution at FIA. And of course, we have also our three esteemed panelists who we are very lucky to have join us today, starting with Alistair Sayers, head of funding and optimization working at UBS in collateral management. Next, we have John Schlamp, who is Senior Vice President at Macquarie Futures USA. And last but not least, Diane Sherman, Director and Head of Global Collateral Management at Bank of America. These panelists come with a wealth of knowledge and insights. And like I said, we're quite lucky to have them join us today. So without further ado, I would like to hand the mic back to Don, and we can get started.
Oh, great. Thank you, Linda. We appreciate SmartStream for sponsoring this important industry discussion today. Just a couple of logistical points to get out of the way. The session will be, the panelist Q&A will be about approximately 30 minutes long, and then we will have a 15 minutes Q&A session afterwards. So please submit your questions using the question functionality within Zoom. The webinar will be recorded for to be posted on the website within about 24 hours. So with that, we're going to get started here. I'll ask the panelists to unmute themselves if they are on mute. We have Alistair, we have John, and we have Diane, who is unfortunately not able to join by video, but she is on audio. So we're going to start here. We're going to start with a discussion here around the day in the life of a margin call. We're going to go over some aspects of the margin processing flow from the clearing perspective at a high level. And we're going to start with you. I'll start with you, Diane. Can you just give us some high level discussion points around the workflows that you see on a typical day in the life of a margin call?
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Don. Thanks, Don, Linda, and the FIA for having me as a panelist today. This is an extremely timely topic at most clearing firms as funding treasury management has become the center stage through the pandemic. To start off, and not to spend too much time, I know there's a wide range of backgrounds and expertise on our call right now, but sometimes I find it useful to start with a basic flow when explaining the funding process at an FCM, as we're calling it a day in the life of a margin call. There's three main parties involved in the day-to-day funding process. You have the CCP, who faces the FCM on the client, you have the FCM, or multiple FCMs who face the CCP on the client's behalf. And then you have the client who faces the FCM. All have various subcomponents to how their businesses are managed within their respective roles. As you can see in the box, the FCM, for example, there's a custody, bank, depository relationship, risk management, credit teams, our regulatory management, treasury, operations, and technology, just to name a few, that interact on a daily basis as part of this daily margin flow. As an example, you have client A who may face multiple clearing members depending on their own business model. In the U.S., for example, the FCM acts as an agent between the client and the CCP in meeting the margin call on a daily basis, or what we refer to as T plus zero, with the client typically meeting their call on a T plus one basis for that prior day margin. Internal teams such as our credit, risk review, client worthiness, establish the trading limits and monitor exposure on the client's behalf. As margin is for the most part is self-funded by the client, there is an overnight funding component for the intraday initial margin, variation margin, or unmet margin call that the clearing member is responsible for, with a cost of funding associated with it at times. So fast forward to the height of the pandemic, where there was unforeseen market volatility for a period of days / weeks, and the intraday funding component for many was material, costly, and unpredictable. Funding resources became a high focus, and depending on the product, futures, or OTC cleared, such regulatory funding factors came into play, as such as client deficits, LSOC funding, unmet margin calls, unallocated trades, all played a part in the height of the pandemic, and the role of Treasury became center stage, and margin levels were highly elevated, and the bulk of our intraday margin was due to variation margin calls. We'll get into that further as we start to talk about the impact on residual interest later on in the presentation. So balance sheet management, collateral management, which has been a key component to the FCMs, has caught more awareness, especially in terms of sourcing internal funding, what are the sources of liquidity, risk management within the FCMs, working closely on a real-time basis to manage the process that you see pictured on the slide now. So at this moment, looking at awareness around optimal ways and best practices to manage that relationship between the CCP, FCM, and client is a hot focus. Turn it back to you, Don.
Oh, thanks, Diane. Appreciate it. Alistair, do you have anything else you'd like to add to what Diane said? And is there anything else you'd like that you have from your perspective around the data life of the margin call?
Yeah, I think the key things to call out is, just with such a simple process like this, it's worth calling out just how significant some of the liquidity challenges can be. So I guess we see, if you think about a standard overnight margin call process, you might have a margin call versus the CCP for, say, $500 million on a day. Now, you might... As an FCM, you're going to have to pay that margin call first thing in the morning on T plus one the following day for an overnight margin call. Now, you might expect to receive that from your client, so expect to receive a similar amount, $500 million. But that might actually be split in a client perspective. Say you're receiving $1 billion from clients and actually having to pay out $500 million to other clients. So the net result is that $500 million that you paid to the CCP. So what you actually see on an intraday basis as an FCM is first thing in the morning, you're paying out $500 million to the CCP. You're then paying out another $500 million to your clients, so net $1 billion outflow on a daily basis. And then you're not necessarily going to get the $1 billion from clients back in until much later in the day. So quite a big intraday drop in your cash balance, which is something that really came front and center during the period of volatility, where we suddenly saw margin calls on a daily basis going up and down quite rapidly. Now that's just looking at the overnight margin call process. As Diane mentioned, and as we have in the slide here, oftentimes we're starting to see more and more intraday margin calls being made by the CCPs. And so in that case, you've got an intraday margin call coming in from a CCP, and typically we would manage that on a T plus one basis with our clients. So now you've got not just an intraday liquidity impact from your overnight margin call process, you've also got an overnight liquidity impact from your intraday margin call process. So it has a real impact. Now, I think to add to that complexity, you know, where you have multiple currencies, you know, certainly over here in Europe, you know, a number of different currencies that you might be working across, euros, you know, sterling, some of the Scandinavian markets, etc. So managing those currency levels as well is really a challenge for the FCM.
Thanks, Alistair. That's very insightful. I appreciate the candidness there. John, from a regulatory perspective, what are some of the considerations for clearing firms that you'd like to share in this aspect?
Yeah, thanks, Dan. Before we get into kind of the reg and the reporting, you know, what Alistair mentioned, managing that collateral, you know, it does get complicated as you're dealing with various CCPs, what collateral is acceptable and the haircuts that are applied to that collateral. So, you know, you can see during periods of heightened volatility, which we'll talk about a lot today, how that can be difficult and you know, make it difficult to allocate those that liquidity. On the reg reporting side, you know, we've got the residual interest requirement, which is an end of day requirement, where we need to ensure we're not using one client's funds to satisfy another. A lot of times, this requires is for an FCM to put up the firm's own money, essentially, in the form of a residual interest target. That calculation is done on a daily basis. So during heightened periods of volatility, large calls intraday and end of day could be a bit of a crutch. There's aged margin that must be done on a daily basis. Some complexities we've talked about in the FIA circle around aged margin includes holiday processing, which has been a popular topic. And, you know, do you age or do you not age when banks are closed, but markets are open? There's also aspects of collateral reporting. You know, twice a month we need to do the CIDR reporting, the SEG investment detail reporting, where we outline you know, cash and non-cash collateral, and then also with foreign broker balances. So any FCMs clearing business for you know, through a non-U.S. broker, we need to report those balances, again, cash and securities, on a daily basis. So, you know, there's a lot that goes into this, a lot of reporting, a lot of eyes on all the cash movements and the liquidity as it's moving. So you can see really quickly, I mean, you know, it seems like a simple process, but you throw some volatility into the market, you know, unclaimed give-ups we've talked about quite a bit in FIA circles. You can see how it adds complexity and strain to the system.
Yeah, thanks, John. Yeah, I think your point, the chart that you see on your screen is a very, very simplified version of the margin process flow. I think if we try to get any deeper, I think it would become a meme for complicated processes. So we definitely, yeah, we try to keep it pretty high level. You did mention holiday processing, you know, just using residual interest and some of the holiday processing challenges. So one of the things our members are interested in is a big thing that has come up, especially after the March, you know, volatility. Good Friday was a challenge because of the way it fell, particularly in the U.S. Same thing with the 4th of July holiday. We have Veterans Day coming up. From the clearing firm perspective, do you have processes in place, or do you prepare for each of those individually as they come along because of the uniqueness of being where the banks are closed or the banks are open but the markets are closed, et cetera? In other words, are you constantly reviewing that as part of your operational process and within the clearing firms?
We do, and you know, we have internal checklists every time the holidays are approaching. You know, there's another tricky one coming up, Veterans Day here in the U.S. So those checklists, you know, do happen internally, but also you know, we'll get notifications from CCPs who's processing, who's not. But you know, there are occasions historically where, you know, communication has not always been clear. You know, whether, again, back to age margin calls, whether we need to, you know, age calls for that day when banks are closed. So, internally, we do the best we can through our processes, but a lot of it is still reliant on, getting those notifications from regulators or CCPs directly.
Okay, great. Thanks, Sean. Just a reminder to everyone, if you have any questions, to please use the question box in the Zoom to submit your questions. And with that, we're going to transition to some of the challenges, which we've touched on a little bit. John, you just mentioned some of them there, and others have mentioned them as well already. But let's dive into some specifics. Diane, I'm gonna jump to you first. Go back to you. What are some of the internal challenges and considerations that clearing firms face? I know we sort of mentioned the overnight funding piece of it. There's also balance sheet, capital costs, etc. Would you mind just kind of giving some color on that?
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Don. Definitely, overnight, balance sheet pressure as initial margin increases, if it's in the form of cash, we will see increases in our balance sheet. A lot of it is managing client relationships, managing the balance between cash and non-cash. I think John mentioned earlier, non-cash is becoming a larger component. Clients are thinking about cheapest ways to fund on their end as well. So expansion of eligible collateral at the exchanges is, becoming a larger topic, concentration limits and ability to pledge, all sorts of maybe non-vanilla securities to exchanges to meet that margin and reduce some of the balance sheet pressures that some of the firms are facing. I would say that was very much recognized internally. And I think I'd also add risk management at SCMs. We all have ways to predict impacts of the market volatility on a given portfolio. But more specifically, the challenges comes where the CCPs have different margin methodologies. Timing of the calls from the CCP, one may call you once a day, others may call continuously. So I think that intraday initial margin variation, margin visibility in terms of trying to model becomes very subjective in some cases, as there's varying methods to the model. And helping to predict what that impact will have on funding at the end of the day.
Thanks, Diane. Alistair, is there anything you want to add in terms of internal challenges from your perspective? And then also maybe talk a little bit about some of the client challenges you face when calling clients for margin and managing their collateral.
Yeah, sure, Don. I guess one of the key points over the recent volatility, I guess, was making sure that any of the internal challenges that we as FCMs face don't have a knock-on impact to clients. So, obviously for a firm like UBS, it's important that as our clients navigate the volatility just as we were, that we're there for them. And, that can be anything from ensuring timely execution of trading down to, the accuracy of the post-trade processing. And making sure that at the end of the day, all the decks were clear and you were ready to go into the following day afresh. I'm happy that we weren't subject to any major disruption during the period, but I think it was definitely a learning point just how important understanding what some of these operational implications or internal implications had on clients. I think that was a really key one. Certainly we definitely saw an uptick in the desire for clients to pledge non-cash collateral. So, from their perspective, there were liquidity challenges as well. That could come from a core liquidity challenge, or if suddenly the collateral that you're having to post increases, you suddenly need to start thinking about the implications of negative rates. Certainly that's something in Europe that has become relatively widespread. As we look forward, potentially something that will impact elsewhere as well. So, I think the non-cash collateral piece is an interesting one to talk about, because I think typically that's harder for clearing firms to manage. A big chunk of cash is very simple and easy to do. A number of different securities certainly adds additional complexity. You know, you need to start thinking about eligibility versus the client versus eligibility versus the CCP. And, you know, if there are multiple different CCPs that that the FCM is facing off to, you know, as we're aware, that there is an array of different eligibility schedules out there in the market. So trying to manage that is important. And then I guess, you know, managing the necessary client protection rules, you know, so whether that's the CAS regime in the UK, or just the other client protection rules where clients are giving assets on a pledge basis as opposed to a title transfer basis. These are all kind of challenges that you know, the FCMs are gonna face. You know, and if you are taking that non-cash collateral, there's then the monetization side of it as well. You know, how do you actually you know, potentially take that collateral and make sure you are actually using it as eligible collateral wherever it needs to go.
Great. Thank you, Alistair. That was very insightful. And that's a perfect transition to John, to what I was going to ask you, and that is the some of the challenges that clearing firms face in terms of managing, you know, the various margin methodologies, rules, and processes for each CCP, which can be very bespoke in nature. Just, you know, eligible collateral alone, right? Trying to manage across all the different CCPs. Do you mind to give us some insight on that, please?
Sure. You know, as Diane mentioned, risk management has really come to the forefront during this volatile period and with the election coming up. So there's been a bit of a focus to, you know, forecast better and better your cash flow expectations. You know, we do get communications, not only holiday processing, but also from CCPs when span arrays may change or margin limits may change. So we have to take that in, consider what is the impact going to be to our client, and do we now put them into a credit breach, perhaps, with our internal limits. You know, the span arrays could be wrong. CCPs do make mistakes, and sometimes span arrays will go out and will, you know, perhaps have an inflated margin call go out to a client. Some other challenges include intraday calls, as Alistair mentioned earlier. Routine, you know, during heightened periods of volatility, we'll see intraday calls come in and then, you know, in the next 30 minutes or so, maybe they'll drop. So you have folks in the cash management and treasury function scrambling for liquidity just to have that call drop. You know, intraday pricing is a big topic, right? You know, pricing illiquid contract months, looking at instruments that still form part of the brokered market, but yet are traded as cleared futures. You know, we lack as FCMs transparency into intraday pricing on a good subset of products. So we have to sophisticate ourselves. Start looking into correlations, creating proxies, extrapolating curves and what have you, all, you know, to risk manage the FCM as best we can. And then, as you mentioned, Don, the various margin methodologies and integrating those into risk management systems. I mean, you've got SPAN, which there's multiple versions of. You've got VAR models, strategy margining. And, you know, HVAR, which is coming, which is, this is a great slide we have up on the screen right now. You know, HVAR, we should start seeing that roll out more and more in 2021. And what this slide shows you is, you know, the E-mini future, for example, more of a step-up approach to margin adjustments, whereby if you look in the middle slide there, or middle graph there, it's more of a gradual uptick in periods of volatility, which is what an HVAR model gives you. So there's not that shock rise in initial margin and, you know, subsequent potential liquidity crunch within a firm.
So, John, does that make that makes a material difference for a firm with not having to deal with the step ups like that? Correct? Is it a material difference between the two? from an operational management process perspective?
It could be. It could be. I can't say yes or no one way or another, but it certainly could be at smaller FCMs. The step up could, turn into a liquidity issue. So a more gradual approach, does make sense to kind of soften the liquidity blow, so to speak.
Okay, great. Thanks, Sean. We've got about 5 minutes before we're going to start the Q&A. As a reminder to please submit questions, we've got several questions already. We've got a few questions that we've received. If you have any additional ones, please share them now. So for the last 5 minutes or so here, we want to talk about how the industry overcomes some of these challenges that we've discussed, what's come up with several times already. Most all of you have mentioned at one point or another the March volatility, high volume, high volatility period, and the impact that it that it had on margin processing. And I assume there, and I know from discussions in other FIA groups and other operational areas, things such as processing give-ups, et cetera, there have been a lot of lessons learned that have come out of that. We, FIA, have a lessons learned working group and committee that we've been working on for several months to capture some of those lessons learned. And what are some of the, not only during the, that we learned during the March volatility, but just in general, what are some of the potential solutions that some of you have in mind, be it technology or industry solutions where we can come together as an industry and help solve some of these challenges? Alistair, I'll go to you first on that. If you'd like to add something there on some potential solutions.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think, obviously, as volumes have exploded and volatility moved, the need to stay very close to what's happening and ensure that we're operating quickly and in an agile manner, I think, is important. I think the move across the industry where CCPs are starting to roll out APIs should be very, very well received. Whether that's allowing individual clearing firms to be able to connect directly to CCPs and improve that connectivity, that's good. Or alternatively, allowing, vendors to step in and connect to those APIs and therefore create standardization back out to the clearing member community. I think that's very beneficial. I think we have to accept that there's a number of different CCPs that exist out there, and they each have different methodologies, as John touched on, different ways that we might interact with them operationally, these kind of things. So creating that standardization, I think, is absolutely key to allow the industry to overcome some of these challenges.
Thanks, Alistair. Yeah, and just before I get to you, Diane, I just want to comment on, I mentioned the lessons learned earlier from the crisis, from the operational perspective, specifically the give-ups that we've been working on. And the first work stream to come out of that was a CCP engagement work stream. We're working with all of the CCPs globally on some recommendations for, improving T+0 and T+1 processing. And that work stream is in its infancy, but I can say that the cooperation and the support and the enthusiasm between the CCPs and the clearing firms working together so far has been really good. And I hope is a look into the future as we try to standardize more things within the industry. Diane, what about from your perspective? What are some of the solutions to some of these challenges that you have in mind?
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Don. Just kind of to work off your last point there, the management of the unallocated trades, right, the unpredictable component, something sits in a suspense account and our, ability to model that risk for that, setting an industry protocol or governance process around that, as it does have funding implications until that trade is truly allocated. I would say that would be a great industry solution if we could work towards that. And again, back to Alistair's point, pushing for standardization across the CCPs. And as we mentioned, it's very convoluted. All CCPs have varying ways of acceptable collateral, but where we can standardize would, potentially help all manage across the various CCPs, partnering with the vendors to create efficient collateral management between, you know, those three components on that first slide, you know, the client, CCP, and the FCM. I think that is going to be the future, kind of where we're moving towards. Again, the APIs that are going to be available where we can connect. I think there will be a lot more STP processing involved and optimization in the workflows.
Great. Thanks, Diane. John, do you have anything to add? Solutions?
Yeah. You know, I would kind of just echo the vendor and the standardization. You know, I fully realize CCPs need to compete in the end. But, you know, if we can standardize as much as possible, because, you know, FCMs, I feel, serve a risk management function, and we need to be able to monitor our clients' activity throughout the day and be able to forecast adverse effects in the market. So, vendor solutions, there's a few out there that are in the margin in the risk management space. But even those, you know, plugging those into the various margin models that are out there is difficult. And then the added complexity, if perhaps you're not a member of a market, you know, but you have clients trading it. So yeah, more and more complexity. So, you know, more and more vendor engagement would be good. I mentioned before, things to look at are data aggregators, so to speak, where you can get additional market data points that do not come through a typical market data provider, where you can build out proxies or look at correlated products to, again, get transparency into those those brokered markets. So that would be a big benefit and a big help to the industry. And then one other thing that's come up in FIA historically, and I know is on Walt's radar a bit, at least historically, is the capital charges that margin attracts. In the end, the initial margin we collect from a client, we pass it through to the exchange to cover the margin requirement, but yet we take a capital charge on that. You know, there's other pass-through items in the life of the futures trade, i.e. fees, which we do not take a capital charge on, but yet they're same kind of high level, same sort of process. We're collecting from the client and passing it on to the CCP. So, there should be further discussions, I think, in the capital space, as it is a pass-through, perhaps, you know, it shouldn't be an 8% capital charge, maybe only a 4% capital charge or something along those lines. So I think those are, you know, conversations that should happen and need to happen within the industry in order to, improve risk management and take risk out of the system as much as possible.
Thanks, John. I appreciate that. So before we head to the audience Q&A, it looks like we've got several questions here. We've got several different questions here. So I'm gonna pick some of the questions here, and then I'm just gonna ask them to the panelists here, and whoever wants to answer them, go ahead. So the first question is, it gets back to the holiday. It's a holiday related question. Is what is the best practice / common practice in the industry regarding whether an FCM treats margin calls as an aged call due to a holiday? I don't know if anybody wants to answer that or can answer that question.
I'm not on the immediate front line, so Diane or Elsar, correct me if I'm wrong, but it's essentially typically we get a notification, whether that comes from, I think it typically comes from the regulators, yeah, whether or not you're going to age that day or not. So typically it's a notification. So again, you need folks focused on their emails and escalating those notifications when they come in.
Okay. Next question here is, are there any methods that FCMs are using to try and predict and forecast variation margin?
Yeah, I can
absolutely.
Take that, yeah, I mean, yeah. Do you want to go first, John? Go on.
I think I've hammered this one already. I mean, it comes down to intraday pricing and the availability of prices. my biggest, I feel the biggest crutch in the industry are the formerly OTC products that are still brokered, because we don't get it priced until the end of the day. And we could wake up to a large margin call that we didn't know about. So that's, you know, my biggest pain point from my perspective.
Yeah, I mean, I might just add, I mean, this is absolutely the, you know, the holy grail for FCMs, to be able to anticipate what your liquidity requirements are. But it's an incredibly challenging topic. You know, not, you've got the intraday pricing aspect of it. And then you've also got the fact that in a period of high volatility where, you know, prices are moving, that's typically because you have a high level of trading activity. So you've got that additional complexity of forecasting a current portfolio with, you know, prices that are moving, but also taking into account the fact that some of those transactions will have been sold out of, you know, additional transactions will have come on. So an incredibly complex topic to really kind of understand and forecast that.
Okay, great.
Thank you. And I would just add that, you know, with the varying methodologies, it's hard to model, again, internally, what the intraday moves are going to look like.
Okay, great. Thanks, Diane. Thanks, everyone. Next question, I'm going to paraphrase this one. And Diane, I'll tee it up for you since you can't see us live. The paraphrase of the question is around, you know, how clearing firms funded the intraday margin requirements to CCPs before clients paid their margin requirements during the volatility. I think the question there is really, was there anything different, or was it what was different during that period? Was there anything extra that was required or from the clearing firm perspective?
Yeah, sure. I think it's very much, you know, regulatory driven. You know, as we know, the CFTC has requirements on, you know, how and what is fungible margin in terms of usage for intraday basis. So depending on the product, you know, we may have sources of funding through, you know, client excess cash or securities, or in the OTC cleared space, you know, we have to abide by our LSOC funding rules. So I would say it really depends. I think the main component really was the unpredictability and the size of those, you know, of those intraday funding needs during the, you know, height of the pandemic. Nothing I would say changed in terms of how we would look to meet those margin calls. It was more the potential size of those and, you know, the varying products driving it. Changes where you're getting your funding from and the impact on residual interest.
Okay. So one thing that I might add in there is I think one of the things about this crisis that was very different is, I think certainly the global regulatory response was very quick. It was swift, and I think all of us across the industry have learned from the CCPs, the FCMs, the clients, and also the regulators. And I think the injection of liquidity, you know, you would have seen the coordinated approach to liquidity across the, you know, the G7 community to be able to ensure that in times of crisis, we understand that, you know, liquidity is an issue, not necessarily something specific to the counterparty risk of a firm, but just inherent in the model, and therefore the ability for regulators to vary the amount of liquidity. I think that was something that was very good, very swift, and really contributed to getting the entire industry through that crisis.
Okay, thanks, Alistair. Okay, we've got about 5 minutes left here. We've got several more questions here, so I'm going to try to filter through them really quickly here. One question here, in a step-up process, how does the clearing firm mitigate exposure risk if margin coverage is a gradual process, but the market risk multiplies immediately? I think the question there is around the intraday calls to clients and the multipliers. Is this, you know, if the market's just thinking crude, for example, going is very volatile. Anybody want to comment on that one?
I don't have a good answer, unfortunately, on that one.
Okay. We'll skip that one. There's another comment, just sort of general comment, and I'll just answer this from what I've seen, and it's around the technology and processes there were some challenges that firms had across the industry from a technology perspective in some cases with the over periods during the March volatility period, and I know that has resulted in all clearing firms, CCPs, I think everybody involved in the ecosystem, to review their technology and processes and stress tests and things like that. So that was one comment that, or one question/comment that I wanted to answer there. Another one here, anybody like to discuss any of the trends in cross-margining? Is that something that is run across for any of you that you'd like to make a comment on? This group would be,
I think anything that we can do, as a number of the panelists have mentioned over the course, to just understand what the overall risk exposure is and understand that as quickly as possible, I think is beneficial. So, you know, both in terms of where it can identify where risk really exists and also look to reduce down margin requirements where that is, where that makes sense. So I think that's good. And I think as we look, as you know, more of the OTC derivative market moves towards a cleared approach, I think this becomes increasingly important to look holistically at your product set.
Okay. A couple of questions here that are similar related to data. I think we've mentioned market data challenges a couple times. What are some of the challenges specifically? Are there any specific challenges you want to get into? And why isn't the data more readily available? I think that is that also ties into another question around intraday pricing and whether or not there's any efforts to actually improve that data that are ongoing.
I would love to push efforts there, one way or another, because it is a challenge and it's a costly one to overcome. As I mentioned before, there are vendors out there and vendor solutions and data aggregators where you can get sophisticated enough and build out calculations to, kind of forecast those products. It's going to continue to be a challenge. We're quickly coming into another volatile period. That is our U.S. election. As Alistair mentioned earlier, our intraday, if you were to attempt to forecast, you may be forecasting perhaps a net call 1 hour, and then the next hour, all of a sudden, you're forecasting an excess. So I think intraday pricing and further transparency into the brokered markets is something we should look to improve and get on the docket. It's becoming more and more challenged. I think more and more firms are becoming exposed during heightened volatility that COVID has created, and soon our elections will as well.
Thanks, John. I think we'll take one more. There's one more question here. It actually is related a little bit to what you just mentioned. It goes back to the whole VAR versus SPAN models. And the question is whether or not you see any issues with the models amplifying liquidity stress by increasing the margin requirements during the periods of high stress compared to the current SPAN models. Do you think that specifically in preparation for the upcoming U.S. election, do you see any challenges there or any differences that you really need to account for in the VAR versus SPAN model there?
VAR models, there's always a bit of finesse involved. We try the best we can to mimic what the exchange will be calling. We have other VAR-based models where perhaps we look at what a client may have at risk using various shocks applied to the various asset classes. So there's ways, there's methods firms can employ to protect themselves, but all of this requires investment and that market data to make it, hum along, and so to speak. So there are options out there.
Okay. And then one last question that just popped up that I think is a really good question is we've kind of touched on the high level margin process. In terms of the margin call process, it could be either both CCP versus client calls. How much automation is involved in today's processes? And I know obviously that varies by firm and whatnot, but is there a considerable amount of manual processing and manual effort that still goes into those into the processing of those from the CCP versus client? Diane, I'll let you answer that first if you would like.
Yeah. Yep, sure. I would say there is still, a handful of manual intervention involved. Where their CCPs have, straight connectivity, obviously is straight through processing as much as we can, but all the varying CCPs have different ways of calling for the margin. Some is still very manual. Some is email communication. Others are GUIs. So I'd say it's still a mixed bag, but highly operational, and still rely a lot on our operations teams to, physically meet a call via either cash and or, securities.
Okay, great. Alistair, anything you want to add there as well?
No, I think we do see a difference between the CCP and the client space. I think there's there's definitely varying degrees of automation there, both in terms of, as an SCM, what we can provide to clients and other things that we can build internally. But, also the ability for a client and an SCM to be able to connect, right? There's always going to be a hurdle to some kind of investment hurdle to create automation, which creates a really interesting dynamic, I think, on the client side. How much of that cost do you as an FTM want to push to your clients versus where are the areas that you can actually create that service for your clients so that they can have that automation? I think with Clearing Firm and the CCP, it really comes down to kind of how much we want to do and how much standardization, back to, Diane's points and the points that we made earlier around standardization with the CCPs to make that automation better, which, I think there is some great work out there. There's some great vendors out there. I think we've still got a way to go.
Great. All right. All right. Thank you, everyone. We're only a couple minutes over. Thank you to all the panelists. This was very insightful, very informative. I'm glad you're able to participate, and of course, thank you to SmartStream for sponsoring this webinar today. We're very thankful to be able to provide this information to the industry. So, with that, thank you, everyone, and have a good day.